welcome to the Financial Planners South Africa podcast, a show dedicated to driving the positive evolution of financial advice, specifically in South Africa. To join a global community of financial advisors sharing and learning with one another to drive the positive evolution of financial advice, head to xyadvisor.com. Portfolio Metrics is thrilled to bring you this podcast in support of our common passion, people and the evolution of wealth management. Our global business links precision investment management to expert financial advice through partnerships and technology. Portfolio Metrics is an authorized financial services provider. Visual, interactive, meaningful, productive. Four values underpinning AssetMap, a financial planning platform loved by advisors and their clients. This episode is proudly brought to you by Alan Gray. They say it's important to live for today. Although that might be true, we can't forget to plan for tomorrow. There's a lot of it left, after all. Alan Gray is an authorized financial services provider. Visit www.alangray.co.za to learn how we build long-term wealth for clients. Good morning, Hendrik Crafford. Thank you so much for joining us today on the Financial Planners South Africa podcast. It is my privilege to have you here as our guest. You've been on numerous podcasts before, but for those that haven't heard your name before and haven't heard the Cruffies brand, please can you just give us a little bit of background of who you are and what you're up to?
Thank you very much, Louis, and good morning for you and also for all our listeners that will be listening to the podcast. Yeah, privileged to be with you. And yeah, I think the podcast fits into the whole thing of Cruffies Financial Coaching. I see myself as a financial coaching artist. And yeah, my mission in life is if I can add value to individuals and companies that I interact with, I'm in my happy place zone. So yeah, so wonderful to be here, Louis.
Great. You mentioned a artist in there, and that is not something that we often hear in the more analytical financial planning realm. Why artist?
Yeah, Louis, a very good question. You know, I myself has been a financial advisor and being in the financial industry for the past 31 years been a financial advisor for a large part of that and then in management. And yeah, about 15, 16 years ago, alongside the finance industry that always intrigued me, I started exploring financial or coaching at such at that point in time. And for me, the more I played with it, I saw the interrelationship between understanding our clients and as unique human beings and their, how they think about money, how they feel about money, their values, and the importance that that plays into the whole thing of the figures and supporting it, that we must bring those two together. And I always say when I talk to students at the universities around the career of financial planning, I say, in the past I said that the wonderful thing is of financial planning and our careers is that we bring together the whole thing of contracts, which attorneys does, and tax, which the accountants do. And if we bring that together, we actually at the center bring making sure that our clients' contractual parts, like the wills, the buy and sell agreements, and on the other side, the financial planning part, can play out and come together. However, I think the new thing for me is that if we also bring together those things that's dear and important for our clients from a financial coaching side and integrate that with the agreements and the numbers, we actually creating, that's why we are professionals, is bringing all that together in one part. However, it's not something that's only a science, it's also an art, because I think there's really something that we need to dance with between those three parts and circles, you know, where those vectors come together.
That's so true. And they talk about, you know, the human side or the personal side and then the technical side.
Yeah.
And, you know, we don't spend a lot of time training the personal skills and the human skills. And I know you've been involved in helping a lot of financial planners start building that. Maybe give us a little bit of a background around what you've been doing, specifically around the financial planner training sessions.
Yeah, so perhaps it can be useful for financial planners that's interested in the human side, a little bit of my own history in terms of where my own journey. I started off initially with starting off with CTE, which is the ground level course at the University of Cape Town's Business School Center for Coaching. Then I explored NLP level 1 and level 2, and then I started engaging with ACC and PCC. I was privileged to be the second group doing PCC at Center for Coaching. And then I did conscious embodiment, how our bodies influence us and how we can use our bodies also to as a conduit, because we live so much in our heads that we actually forget we've got a whole body. With Wendy Palmer, did neuroscience coaching as part of it, then got involved in the Enneagram and also focus balance indicator. And so really walked a journey in terms of seeing what different modalities is out there. And then about 3 years ago, myself and the Center for Coaching at the University of the Free State, we were evaluating new students or students that were doing their final year case studies for, at that stage, BU's financial planning. And we were having this conversation around the human side and not only looking at the figures and the numbers and the contracts. And at that point in time, Shirley was head of the school. She said, but why don't we do something together? And that's where it was initially born, the whole program. And we then, at that point in time, I played with the concept of using my base integral coaching. However, planners were grappling a little bit of moving from cognitive head stuff into the real conversations of changing and the human side. And then Karen, which was my pod coach way back when I did PCC, said that she got involved with Alan Seeler from Australia and ontological coaching. She said, come and do ontological coaching. I joined them on the three-day course, and I said, it's the ontological coaching model is all about having a conversation, seeing people as unique human beings, being a full-time learner, which is so much of what we in any case do as financial planners. And just looking at that conversation and what is the emotions and moods in the conversation, what is the assessments we are making, which is not grounded, what is the assertions we are making, what are we not asking, was so valuable for me that we then started building the initial coaching program, then on the ontological coaching model. And what we then learned was when our planners enjoyed that so much when they attended this course, initially was a three-day intensive course. However, when they got back to the practices, they said, when am I having a coaching conversation with my clients? When am I having figures at financial planner? Which hat must I wear when? And a large part of my work was becoming to coach planners after attending the course of how do I integrate this, where we then started developing the 12-week course, which we've currently got, where we've got then the coaching in one lane now. Every week, a conversation of the integration with financial planning. How do you have a values conversation with a client? How do you look at money scripts? How do you look at the client's money personality, and how does that integrate? How does husbands and wives differ in terms of their approach? And we then develop the program we've currently got, Louis. So a lot of science that went in it, and a lot of mentors. You know, we also, there's a lot of people, especially from the US, that we work with and learn from. So, but yeah, it's a wonderful journey, and I can see the value that people is getting from this engaging in it, and also the different conversations they can then have with their clients.
So you've really explored all there is to coaching and said, what are the best parts that financial planners need to know, not to turn them into coaches, but actually to have better discussions. And I think one thing that comes to mind is that oftentimes we jump into action, right? We want a client to make changes, yet only 20% of them tend to be ready for that change. What would you say to a financial planner that's struggling with a client to take action, with those conversations where, you know, the client might be going round and round trying to figure out what the best way is to move forward? What are the key skills that a financial planner needs to focus on to handle those discussions better?
Yeah, so it's an interesting one, especially when we were still doing the three-day intensive. We got financial planners that the first day in the class said, if you now ask, you know, what is expectations, you know, is then there was a golden thread sometimes. I want to come and learn. Give me the tools so that I can change my client. Yeah, you know, so as if our clients is broken, you know, our clients is not broken. There's something in their finances that's broken or in their lives that's broken that we must guide them to. So and at the end of the day, to your point, if they're not ready, we can't force them to change. So it's a process that we must walk with them and facilitate with them that they get awareness and see what is happening in their own lives. And I think the most important one, Louis, starts with something basic like really listening to our clients, because am I there? And that's a big move. Am I there to give a solution? Because we were trained as professional practitioners to be solution orientated, and I would say great consultants, where we must have the answers. However, the answer that's the answer for me or for the previous client is not necessarily the answer that the client that's sitting in front of me needs. So it starts with something wonderful like really just being present and listening to the clients. You know, somebody the other day said, in your first conversation, most probably you 90% of the total conversation must be a listening conversation, and your client must do 90% of the talking, you know, where most probably the challenge is from a professional planner is I want to sell my value to my client instead of just listening to my client, because how many times do we actually get listened to? You know, so I would say that's the first and most important skill. If we talk about skills, is just how do I listen and how do I then ask questions to understand better, because our clients will most probably tell us stories. However, there's taken for granted beliefs which they will not always tell us, which is a sub layer of what they are saying. So how do we listen for that not spoken to concerns that our clients have? So yeah, just perhaps I think that's most probably, and it's so elementary as just listening. I want to start there. I think that's such a useful skill, you know.
These are skills that, you know, we sometimes think we're great at. You know, we're good listeners or we're good at asking questions. But until you start practicing improving the quality of your questions and, you know, being present and listening to someone, I think you actually realize, oh, hold on, this could have been so much better.
No, it's definitely because, you know, if we just think of listening as while you were talking, I caught myself again there. You know, I'm listening to you, but I'm also listening to conversation in my own head. Instead of just being present and what you are saying, and then just flow from there, not having the answers, because we're so much sometimes so concerned about what is the right answer we're going to give on the question that being asked. And I think then, you know, there's other things that comes with that is, do I have empathy for my client? Am I vulnerable as a financial planner to make myself vulnerable to listen, and also to sometimes say, I don't know, I'll find out. And that again leads to trust, you know, which is so important for a lifelong relationship with our clients. So.
Yeah, Hendrik, and we hear the pushback that, you know, this is going to take so much longer. I don't have the time to sit with my client to do this, or clients aren't ready for this. You know, what's your take on that?
Yeah, interesting. The other day I was facilitating a workshop, and one of the planners said, but my client haven't got the time for these conversations, you know. And I was wondering, why are my client not having the time for me to have a conversation? Because that's actually concerning, because is the client only making time for me to give that short cryptic numbers feedback? Is that what the client sees that is actually the value that I can add as a financial planner? Or is there something more? Because I think what I experience is because I also facilitate coaching conversations with independent financial advisors with their clients. And what I see, the clients is open for those conversations as soon as they understand that you are actually interested in them. We as human beings love that people want to hear our story. So I think it's that paradox. Firstly, the paradox of making time to listen to the client and really listen to the client's stories, and then adding from there, adding real value to our clients. That's one part. And then most probably the other part is a paradox in our own heads is, how am I going to be paid for that time that I'm sitting with the client?
Yeah, that's so true, hey. These are important things to consider. And I'm wondering what the expectations are that we're creating for clients when they come into the meeting. You know, like you mentioned, is this advisor wearing his legal hat or his accounting hat in terms of the services they provide? But using coaching and the coaching conversations, I think slowly but surely clients are expecting deeper conversations, and they're expecting the conversations around the, you know, the relationship with money and the history with money. You mentioned that earlier, you know, the money scripts and a couple of the tools that financial planners can use. Is there anyone that stands out that that you want to unpack a little bit that's really been helpful for financial planners that you've coached?
Yeah, so the first, and also I think it's a personality thing, and it's also to gauge what is your client for open, and I want to go back one step. I think the positioning of what we are talking about here, where we bring the human side, the legal side, and the financial side in terms of tax and cash flows and stuff together, is most probably also foreign for our clients out there. So how do I position my value proposition with my client? How do I open up that conversation with my client? Because I think there's most probably, if I position myself as a financial advisor or financial planner, there's also a history in our clients' heads of what is the expectation I can have from a financial planner. So how do I position my different value proposition, my uniqueness, my human approach to financial planning with the client? And I think there's a few simple tools that one can use that's not going to even cost you any money, which just talks to conversations. Firstly, how do you open up in terms of your conversations, you know? And then to your point, if I think about something that stands out, which I'm just flabbergasted each time when I engage with clients, is, you know, if you think about Brett Klontz and them, that money egg exercise of theirs, where you ask a client to draw an egg, which we call the money egg, and then you ask, the egg must be drawn with their left hand, their non-dominant hand, to put them a little bit out of their comfort zone. And you then say, just draw your money memories from childhood in that money egg, and just draw them. And then after they fold up the egg, say, okay, now next to that, write down which of those are positive memories and what of those are negative memories. And what of those then it becomes a conversation. Tell me more about those stories of the pictures you just draw, and how does that influence you today in terms of how you look at money? And that's such a powerful exercise, Louis, as you know, and you make the financial conversation less serious, because we know stats shows us that 50% of clients out there have got money anxiety. So money is most probably something that most people don't want to talk about. It's something that's heavy. Over and above that, it's an assertion that money is bad to talk about, like politics and sex, you know, is is the same. So why can't we make it a little bit lighter also as part of the process? Make it a light conversation, which is not making jokes about it, but because it is serious. But how do you make it fun for your client? How do you make it different? You know, and I think that's making your value proposition also different, you know. So
I love that money egg exercise, and it, you know, it's normalizing the things that we're talking about, saying this is a safe space, we can talk about money and your history and your experiences. And even in our business, you know, as we start asking clients, you know, what was money like growing up? It is amazing to see the habits that they still carry 60, 70, 80 years later, from what they learned from their parents. Obviously, I do that. You do that, Hendrik. We all do that, consciously or subconsciously.
Money is definitely emotional. So you know, and all of us have got it. So and that's, again, back to why is it so important for us as financial planners and for you as a financial planner out there listening to us, is you the guide for your client. And you're there not only that once off when you do the financial plan, it's a journey with your client. Financial planning is a journey because, you know, I always say, you know, there's two parts. There's the planning part, and then life will happen, and the plan will definitely yield to life. And then where are you then to help your client to stay on track and then make the right decisions when they are under pressure? Doesn't help you just there when it's going well. It's also to help in that small moments. And then you must really understand your client, because you must understand that, are your client a saver or a spender? What is important for your client? Is family important for your client? So if a family member is going to be in need, then your client is most probably want to dip into that savings. And is that the right thing at that moment? And where are you then to guide your client on that journey? And your client must also understand that's part of your value proposition. You know? So,
yeah, I think the thing that comes to mind for me is aligning the client's values with their money, you know, and how much time do we spend unpacking values and, you know, having those discussions? It's often not much. And values come up, you know, quite often. How's that played out with the work that you've done with your clients, you know, looking back at your financial planning career?
So interesting. The values one is, what is so powerful of a values discussion for me personally, or using one of the financial personality assessments or also, but if we just stay with the values, the discussion is especially very powerful between husbands and wives, but especially if one can do that values discussion in one conversation where husband and wife is both present, and create a safe space for them to have that discussion. Because I haven't had one values conversation where a husband and wife or partners is in that conversation where they didn't end up actually with different values. What is important for me, you know, and that is a point of conflict normally, which they'll then admit when one talks about it. But in a lot of cases, after understanding it, they can have much more empathy with each other due to the fact that that's important for me, that's important for you, and how can we actually support? And sometimes what is interesting, those contrasting values can actually support each other, you know, whether one wants to have experiences in life, a lifestyle is important for them, where the other person is conservative and wants to make provision and security is more important, is that one can help them live a life in the moment, which they can create memories for themselves and the family. And the other one can help making provision for retirement and making sure that they can still enjoy a good lifestyle when they age together, you know, which in any case, in terms of life transitions, they don't even know if they'll be able to age together. However, they can get the best of both worlds, you know, and plan for both worlds, which help us also then as financial planners to keep them on track if you can have those value conversations.
Yeah, so is it highlighting those things that could potentially derail their plans and saying, let's unpack it, let's talk about it before it happens, or am I missing it?
Yeah, so interesting values discussion, and that comes a little bit back to money scripts most probably. Also, is what I found in the past or sometimes is that somebody will, for instance, say, it's for me important to build a legacy. However, let's say is value number one. The second value is most probably, let's say, making provision for my family and security for my family. Let's say the third value is spiritual. However, then you get something that pops out, which could be something like being philanthropic or something like that, which is also a great one. However, what then happens is that philanthropic and being a builder and building wealth and creating a legacy, all of a sudden in their minds could be opposing values, because the philanthropic one at the bottom could be derailing the creating legacy one, because there's tension between the values. And then it's to say, how do you facilitate that process? Because being philanthropical and creating a legacy could be the same thing. It don't have to be two different things. Is then to say, how do you help the client then to create alignment between the values? Because it could, and you see it sometimes, a business person that's brilliant at building businesses, but then for some other reason, the businesses fail at a point in time. And I've seen it in the past already, that somebody like that most probably grew up, and that comes back to the money scripts in the house, where money is a bad thing and being wealthy is bad. So as soon as they get themselves successful, they destruct that again, you know. So values could also have those tensions, which could be destructive in terms of building wealth, yeah.
I can just imagine how valuable that must be for someone to, you know, realize that they are self-destructing their own financial plan, and how much more valuable that could be than trying to deliver better returns or creating a better financial product within that, and having these conversations, you know, that you're saying are pushing against each other and incorporating. Because you can approach, you know, you can repackage their values essentially and deliver it back to them. I just think it's the skills that you're training financial planners is key to be able to have these more difficult discussions. You know, we call it soft skills, but it should probably be called the hard skills.
Yeah. And the interesting thing is you just start with a conversation, is my experience. And it is a conversation with your client, which you're just asking the questions, and the client is actually giving you the information. In most cases, for the client, it's a aha moment at the stage, you know, and you making actually the clients the captains of their own ships, you know, which takes a huge responsibility from you as a financial planner. You don't have to be the person that now tries to enforce the long-term planning. You're not the person. Back to your first question in terms of how do you help somebody to change, you know, it links here, is if you can get the person to really understand, have clarity in terms of where they are going, have clarity in terms of their goals, and vivid things, and making those declarations, you know, I want to achieve this and this and this. And then it becomes so much clearer for the client, and you actually then just the cheerleader, you know. So you must just shout for them on the side to go, you know. So and they clear on what they actually want to achieve, you know. So
that sounds like a much better role than trying to be the expert that has to have all the knowledge and all the correct answers and can never make a mistake. What has the impact been for the people, the financial planners that have gone through this coach training with you? How has that changed their business, and what is the feedback that you're getting from them?
So I think the wonderful thing is, Louis, and that's most probably part of our process as well as the course, is we put the content out then. You know, in orthological coaching, we talk about way of being. So how do I as an individual see the world? Because how I see the world will impact how I interact with the world, and that will impact on my results. So we give the content to the financial planners, and they then over the 12-week journey, they interact with the content. And our last part of the course is how actually will you integrate this into your practice and in terms of your engagement with your clients. We firstly see a huge shift over the 12 weeks, which most probably the biggest shift is a personal shift. Is I saw a lot of things in my own life change because we do not live in compartments. Is, you know, most probably how I manage my finances is also how I manage my relationships, how I manage my leadership, how I engage with the world. So there's a huge shift for financial planners on a personal base. And then secondly, because we train from tied agents, independent advisors, corporate financial planners, wealth managers that we've trained over the last nearly a year now, we are running the 12-week online one. Before that, also we then trained the 3-day workshops, but specifically with the 12-week one where you've got time to consume and engage with the material. To your point then, how do I see the impact in terms of practices that will differ, you know, over and above the personal growth? One will have financial planners that say, I changed my value proposition totally to a more, we call our process the purpose-driven financial planning process, which is very much based on the principles of life planning, supported then with financial coaching. We see that some planners even change their websites to align to our program, which is hugely satisfactory. Other people will take parts of this and say, okay, I want to change. And then the other part is, due to the fact that we've got these conversations over 12 weeks, people start having conversations. I've just got a commission-based practice. However, if I bring components of this in, how do I bring a different pricing in? They start playing with fees. So there's different growth for different people. And I'm comfortable because I think it's a new way of engaging, a new way of dealing with your customers, a new value proposition you're taking to your customers. And as long as we can be the seeds that's thrown out there that starts growing and bringing a new way of looking at things, that's fine, you know. So whatever you take and where you want to shift, even if it's in small increments, we also offer a once a month coaching conversation where whoever wants to pop in. So you see some of our students pop in back there and sponge in whatever we offer there once a month. We've also got an online forum where we all the students is part of, where we have a little bit of engagement there where we keep on sharing the message. So we also try to keep the conversation going after the 12 weeks, you know. So
it's wonderful to see these communities, you know, build specifically around the coaching conversations. I know, yeah. Obviously, Alan Gray has their coaching training that they've done, which I've been on. Old Mutual does that. You know, you're doing that with the University of Free State. And it's wonderful to just see that being more part of, you know, the tool sets that financial planners should have. People like the CFP board in the States even included the psychology of personal finance now in their curriculum. Would you say this should be compulsory for people working towards their CFP? Does this sit after you've achieved your CFP? Or at what level would you have to be in terms of your financial planning experience before you start working on these skills?
Interesting. And it's interesting conversation, especially with corporates and to have these discussions, because normally you get to a point where they say, we must first train product. Then we must train technical training, and then we must bring the soft skills in. I would turn the pyramid around. I would start and the reason why I'm saying that is not only that due to the fact that I'm involved on the coaching side is I think if you can train somebody initially to have coaching conversations, that becomes a part of your being and DNA as a financial planner. Then when you engage with product training and compliance training and the financial planning part, you will look at that training from the eyes of a coaching conversation. Is I see my client as a unique human being with unique needs, because you know, if you just think of it through the standard fact-find forms, which normally speaks to death, disability, retirement, and perhaps, you know, what wonderful goals have you got, and the client must all of a sudden think up, you know, mm-hmm. goals and give that for you, and then you go and input it. And those forms was designed to sell a product at the old end of the day. Your client coming to sit in front of you don't want to hear about the fact sheet like that last year we paid out 30% death claims due to heart attacks or whatever the case may be. Your client have got a concern. If I pass away, what happens about the business I'm involved? I've got a concern about what's going to happen with my wife and kids. What's going to happen with the extended family that I'm looking after? Those are the concerns our clients have got. So we will still sell the product, but first understand what is my client's concerns, and then we can address it. The same is retirement, I think, is a word that must be banned, you know, because it's just a different stage of my life. So, and in any case, we say clients do not save enough for retirement, so why don't we make it just part of a life journey discussion, you know? So, yeah, now I'm starting to get controversial, yeah.
That's brilliant. I think it's, you know, it's so accurate, and we see that in the business side as well. People don't retire and sit back and, you know, wait to expire. They still want to have a purpose. They still can have different income streams. I think with technology, you know, and even things like becoming an Uber driver, there's ways to supplement your income, but still get that purpose side. And I love that fact that you call it, what did you call it? The purpose led financial planning?
Yeah, purpose-driven financial planning process.
Purpose-driven financial planning. Because without purpose, you know, what are we working towards? And shouldn't we be trying to help our clients find that purpose and get clarity around their purpose? And I mean, you shared your personal purpose statement with me, and I'm wondering if you'd be comfortable sharing that with us, just so that listeners can get a sense of, you know, why it is that you're so passionate about these topics.
Specifically, years back, most probably 15, 16, 17 years back, I had one of those weekends where I reflected where I'm going now with my life. And specifically that, out of there, I said to myself that if I can have conversations with companies and individuals to add to them for development purposes, I'll be happy. So developing people and organizations through conversations, that's my purpose statement. And ultimately to glorify God through that. At this point in time, it's then spreading the word of financial coaching artistry and helping people through that. And then my main focus is helping financial planners, because I think there's just such a bigger impact. If I can help one financial planner, you know, it's like the seed and the apple, then we can then spread a lot of seeds on the clients, and then also helping clients through financial coaching conversations. So those are my two focus areas, but at the core of it is helping and supporting people to develop, you know, and organizations through financial coaching now. So, yeah, so that, Louis, is my personal purpose statement, you know. So, and yeah, so what I'm doing speaks spot on into that, you know, so yeah.
Thank you for sharing that with us. And it's wonderful to see that passion that shines through. You know, you talk about assisting corporates and getting them to move forward and, you know, training people. What are the things that you think are missing apart from, you know, banning the word retirement? What are the things that if we had a magic wand and we could wave it and change the financial planning profession, what would that be?
Yeah, I if you ask me this question, and I think most probably if you go and listen to some of my past podcasts a year ago, I would have most probably said the one central thing is ban commission and that we all just work on fees. But it's the more I work with it, it's that was one of my mentors always say, if you look at some of the assessments you make yourself, is it a thick or a thin assessment? And that was a very thin assessment, you know, so it was not grounded that much, because our demographics in South Africa is, and I think across the world, it's not just the South African problem is two different over if you look across the total population. Talking to your magic wand, I think it's different for different market segments, but I think core of it is back to my initial assessment is how is people remunerated. So and I know it's not that easy, but I think there's something fundamental is because the challenge is for a tied agent just starting out in the industry working for a company out there, and I must pay my own bills at the end of the month. It's very difficult not to get into a conversation around what are you currently paying in terms of your premium at XY company that you're working for. I give you now policy at company P and now at and saving you 400 rand a month, and I'm the hero, but I know I'm going to be able to buy bread at the end of the month. So it's very, very difficult. And then there's also a customer story at the back end where the customer is so used to free advice from a financial planner or being sold free advice between brackets, specifically in the larger market, is that there's also education part. So yeah, to your question, most probably then two things, if we've had a magic wand, is to understand actually because the good story counter to that thin stories is I've had people now on courses of mine that just does financial coaching in that lower segment market where people is prepared to pay 500 rand an hour or 750 rand an hour for just financial coaching, helping me with my debt, helping me with my budget. It's also a perception thing. So I think there's work to do on our financial planners side, but also I think there's a work also to be done on a consumer side. However, it fundamentally is we need to integrate the human side of money as part of the technical side of money. And product is just the outcome of that and mustn't be the sole reason why I am actually engaging with clients. So I think that's the worst thing one can do is selling or starting a product conversation with a client before any one of that other three conversations.
Yeah. Hendrik, I completely agree with you. I think it's around aligning the incentives, you know, getting the financial planner or the advisor's incentives aligned with the clients. And, you know, I know you've been involved in a couple of businesses that have tried to do that, but it's probably not as easy as what we think to just say, hey, pay your financial planner's a salary and that'll fix everything. You know, that comes with its own challenges. So if there's a person in a corporate business thinking around, you know, what do we do? What's an easy fix to try and get those incentives aligned with the clients? Like, where would they start?
Yeah, so I think there's a few things is one must think about what is the behavior that you want to incentivize. And because at the old end of the day, to your point is, company can also not pay out salaries if there's not a flow of income at the back end. So most probably the first fundamental question that the company must then answer is, on a company level, do I still want to fund my distribution model from commission, or do I want to fund my distribution model from fees? So that's a fundamental strategic question that must be answered. And then you must secondly say, if I answer that question, and it can be either or also that answer, because, you know, one can say fundamentally we get our income from funds under management, and that then funds our model, but we also throw in all life commission, et cetera, goes in to that pool, and then we pay salaries and bonuses at the front end. And then one can start becoming creative is to say, you know, do I pay a planner just starting with us most probably for having a human conversation with a client. Then I pay the person for doing a full needs analysis. Then I do the pay the person for to still have a sales environment that's motivational, and then you say, okay, but that's supported by a fixed salary and nearly like an article clerk, you know, in an audit, in the more progressive audit firms where you'll pay the person a basic income plus then incentives and perhaps a bonus, you know. And then the thing is, you must then just monitor and manage that tightly because you do get people, and that's normally that burns the model, and then it says, but it's such a model can't work, is if you've got people on board that doesn't bring in fees to the company, you know, and then the model burns, and then you revert back to what's that worked in the past, and that's then commission, you know, and then you say, but that's the only thing that motivates people. But yeah, that's my few thoughts on it. But yeah, it's a ongoing debate that we continuously must have with each other. But we see there is firms that does it successfully, you know, to do it the other way around. You know, so.
Yeah, I think that balance between, you know, the bar to enter new financial planners, but also the quality of financial planners, you know, like you said, that values alignment, you know, it comes to mind, aligning the financial planner and the business values so that we can service the client at the end of the day. So it's great to see how your thinking has changed, you know, as things develop and play out. We, at one point, you know, we expected RDR to massively change the financial planning, you know, structures that we're so used to in South Africa, and that ended up not panning out to the extent that, you know, a lot of us expected. So do you still think that, you know, the regulations that we can see from the US and the UK and Australia, do we think that we can still apply that in a South African base?
Yeah, good question, Louis. I just want to jump back one thing, perhaps just as a thought for new entering advisors. I think one of the problems that I experience is there's a lot of companies that bring internship programs in. However, there's also a big component of those people that is misusing those companies that's got internships by just onboarding, coming in, and they see it as a foot in the door. They don't really want to become financial planners. They're not heart and soul financial planners. They're just coming in, and then as soon as they're in the large corporate or the bigger financial advice firm, and after they received all the training, they start looking for a salary job somewhere else in the system. And they're not heart and soul actually financial planners. I think that's the one misuse, and it's the one thing also that one as an industry must apply our minds. Then to your point, I want to turn the question around. I think we don't have to worry about RDR. We don't have to worry about legislation, etc. If we as a financial industry say we are professionals, we bring the human side of money, the professional side of money, the legal side, the figure side, and we build great relationships with our clients and we build businesses around those principles, I can't see that we, in any case, will lose one wink of sleep at night, because then we are doing the right things for our clients. It's easier said than done, but I think if we can change our own way of being and engaging with our clients and do that one drop of a time, you know, that old 1% rule, if I can each day improve my customer service with 1%, if I can increase my knowledge each day with 1%, if I can each day increase my communication skills with 1%, then, you know, we full-time learners, we are growing with our clients and whatever. Then I think actually we don't need legislation, because legislation is actually just there to protect people against bad practices. But if we've got the right thing in our hearts and doing the right thing, then we don't have to worry about that, you know. So yeah,
you know, XY Advisor is all about the positive evolution of financial advice, and you know what you're saying is that we should just carry on pushing this industry forward and, you know, not worry too much about the legislative component that's there to protect and not necessarily there to move us forward into, you know, a fully fledged profession, which I think we're getting to. And Hendrik, thank you so much. I think that's a great way to end today's discussion. I can see your passion that you have for, you know, helping financial planners and organizations deliver better advice through your curiosity, you know, scratching under every rock to see what are valuable skills that financial planners should be working on. And thank you so much for today's conversation. I thoroughly enjoyed it.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Louis, for the opportunity and for all the planners that will listen to this. Thank you very much for listening to us. And let's just go out there and improve ourselves and just grow, and then we'll push the industry to a new level and just build on that professionality. I agree, Louis.
Thank you, Hendrik.